Thank you, folks, for coming out today. It's a real pleasure to be here. My wife and I met each other over a kind of shared love of Bob Dylan. And it's always nice to come and see the town where he was born, although I'm not entirely sure how much of his life he actually spent here. But it's a great place to be. And it's great to get out of the Twin Cities for a little while. I'm sure you see it all on the news. It can be an eventful place, so it's nice just to get away from them and take a breather. Just to give you a little introduction about the centre and what it is that we do, this is a question I've taken to asking people now. Hands up, who's ever saw the movie How the West Was Won? One hand goes up there, two hands, three hands. It's this old kind of epic that's got Jimmy Stewart, Henry Fonda, John Wayne, Harry Morgan's in it. Everybody's basically in that film. And it starts off, it tells a story of several generations of this family. As Jimmy Stewart, I think, is a trapper in the Appalachians, and this family kind of moves across the continent. And it ends up with George Peppard from the A-Team, who's this sheriff in New Mexico or somewhere, I think. And at the end of the movie, he has to face down these bandits. And one of them, I think, might be played by Lee Van Cleef, I'm not sure. But at the end of the movie, you know, he faces down these bandits, he upholds law and order in this frontier town. And then he advances in this wagon train with Debbie Reynolds off out to California. And they start singing some song, and the camera swoops away from this wagon train. And it shows you, the desert as the camera moves across. And Spencer Tracy's voiceover comes in, and he starts to talk about how the West that these people lived in doesn't exist anymore. But how the prosperity that you see and the world that you see around you today was built by people like that. And as he says this, the camera swoops over Southern California in 1962 and shows you all these gleaming buildings and freeways with cars zipping along them. Like Southern California was probably a lot nicer place in 1962 than it is now. And I think that makes an important point, that film. The point is that the wealth and prosperity that we see around us, and Minnesota is one of the most wealthy and prosperous places in America in terms of GDP per capita, which makes it one of the most wealthy and prosperous places in the world in history. But we can't take that for granted. All this wealth had to come from somewhere. Somebody had to build it. And the people who built it are the people who came before us. And I think this is really important because there are so many policy and political ideas around at the moment which are all based on the idea that there's this lump of wealth out there and that all we've got to do is divvy it up differently or spend some of it, $100 trillion on this, $30 trillion on this, $5 trillion on this. And it's all just crazy numbers. And it's all spending done without any thought for where this money came from. And if you work on that basis, that wealth is just something to be spent, that it's just something to be divided up, if you never devote any thought to where that wealth came from in the first place, you're going to find that at some point, pretty soon, that wealth just isn't there. And so really that's the focus of what we do at the centre across various fields. I'm the economist, but that's my field. But lots of things tie into that. So we cover education specifically. We cover energy policy specifically. And we have another economist on staff. And all of what we're trying to do is look at the various ways that we can make Minnesota and keep Minnesota the wealthy, prosperous place that it is now. A big part of what we do is our annual economy report, which comes out every year, obviously, and that looks at state-level data and compares us to national averages. But what I'm going to talk to you about today is this report here, Minnesota's Border Battles. How state policy affects economies at the margin. What all that means will become slightly more apparent as I go on. And I think the first place to start is here, with a quote from Supreme Court Justice Louis Brandeis. He said, "A single courageous state may, if its citizens choose, serve as a laboratory and try novel social and economic experiments without risk to the rest of the country." Now that's exactly what different states have done. Economic policy varies enormously from one state to another. And you see that if you just look at Minnesota and its neighbors. These here are income and corporate tax rates and brackets for Minnesota and its five neighbors. These come from the 2020 Tax Foundation State Business Tax Climate Index. The 2021 numbers are out just this last week or so, and you'll be hearing about those shortly. But what these numbers show you is that Minnesota and its neighbors are kind of nicely spread throughout the full range of the states that we have. So we see up there at the top with the second lightest tax burden in the country, South Dakota. Dropping down a little bit, North Dakota at 16th. Wisconsin, 26th, so kind of right there in the middle. Iowa's 42nd, that surprises some people, but they have had some very high corporate tax rates. Well, actually, it's the highest in the nation, that's shortly to change. And down there at the bottom, number 45, Minnesota. We're doing about as badly as the Vikings are at the moment, unfortunately, so there's little comfort to be had here. This here, it's slightly hard to see as a slide. It does appear in the report, and what this shows you is income and corporate tax rates and brackets. It's also got sales tax data as well, for the years 2010 to 2018. So I'll explain why I chose those years. 2010 to 2018 was the period when Mark Dayton was governor in Minnesota and Scott Walker was governor in Wisconsin. To listen to some people talk, you'd think that the two states were, you know, North and South Korea or East and West Germany, and that if you crossed into Wisconsin, it was kind of casino capitalism, and over here in Wisconsin, you had Minnesota, you had socialism, and it was, you know, widows wheeling pramfuls of potatoes down the street or whatever. It's not like that. You know, the St. Croix was never the 38th parallel. And I think that's borne out by the fact that even after apparently this, you know, Ayn Rand-inspired war on the public, on the government sector, Wisconsin ranked 26th, according to the Tax Foundation. So it's nowhere up near South Dakota or North Dakota. But I think what this shows you here, and the reason this is there, is that you can see some changes that were made over this period. And I think it's interesting because you can start to think back about how Louis Brandeis framed things. And you can look to see that we actually have levels of taxation, which are spread quite nicely, like I say, through all 50 states. But some of the policies and the changes of those policies over those 8 years are actually quite instructive as well. So over this period, corporate tax rates and brackets in the states remained unchanged, except for in North Dakota where rates fell. The sales tax rate changed only in South Dakota with a 0.5 percentage point increase. And South Dakota and Iowa saw little or no change in income taxes. Wisconsin and North Dakota both cut them, and Minnesota increased them on the highest earners. So again, not only do we have a good range, a good spread of tax burdens, but we've got a good spread of tax policies in this period. Which brings me to my second reason for choosing 2010 to 2018. It's a question of data. What I do is I look at the counties here, and I explain why in a second. But the way it comes out is national data comes out, then state data comes out, then county data comes out. So at the time I did this a few months ago, at that point, 2018 was the most recent year for which some county data existed. So bearing in mind these experiments, we can have a look at economic outcomes and how they differ when we think about how the economic policies differ. What might we expect? What can we theorize from this? What would we expect to see when we look at the data? Well, empirical research does give us some indication. This here is a report from the Tax Foundation. What is the evidence on taxes and growth? And the summary there is kind of the important thing. More and more, the consensus among experts is that taxes on corporate and personal income are particularly harmful to economic growth, with consumption and property taxes less so. Now, obviously, this paper is from 2012. There's been more research onto this since then. We talk about that in the paper. None of it really changes this finding. One thing that I think is worth pointing out is that you will find studies that show you that there is a negative impact of high taxes on growth. You will find studies that tell you that there is no impact of high taxes on growth, but you will not find any study anywhere that tells you that there is a positive impact of high taxes on economic growth. Even people who support higher taxes tell you at best this will have no effect on economic growth. So I think that's an important point to make. Again, it goes back to this idea that wealth is a thing that exists there and will always exist, and it just falls like manna from heaven, and all we have to do is sit around and talk about how we divide it all up. So what I've tried to do with this report is people compare, they look at different economic policies from state to state, and they like to try and look at the economic outcomes from state to state in terms of GDP growth, job growth, etc. And they would ascribe the differences in state-level outcomes to state-level policies. Now, there are problems with that. And I think some of the problems are quite severe, and I'll give you a couple of examples. The first one is North Dakota and Minnesota. If you look at North Dakota over this period, it was the star performer of all the states in terms of economic growth. North Dakota led the nation in terms of GDP growth over this period. So you would look at that and think, well, obviously that shows how brilliant North Dakota's economic policies are. Well, yes and no, actually, I think, because a large chunk of that economic growth in North Dakota, 34% of it, actually came from just two counties. And they're not the urban counties either. They are the counties in the middle of the bakken oil fields. So that's no big surprise, I don't think, to anybody. And obviously the question of whether or not you develop these resources is a policy question. It is a for policymakers to decide, and that can vary, as you see just up the road here, by our stubborn refusal of our policymakers to develop Minnesota's natural resources. But if you look at North Dakota, the positive decision was taken to develop them, and they reap those economic rewards. But however that was a policy decision, it was geology that put those resources there in the first place. So that's a factor that's kind of exogenous in addition to state economic policy, which can also drive economic outcomes. So we have to try and find a way to push those out of our analysis. Another example is the Twin Cities, Twin Cities metro area. The Census Bureau defines metropolitan statistical areas, which are the kind of state's urban areas, and the Twin Cities is the 15th biggest by GDP in the United States. Now there's a wealth of literature, and again, you can find it in the footnotes of this report, that tell you that for various reasons, having a big city is a real boost to your economic growth. But the Twin Cities, again, policy can influence this to some degree, and I think if you look at Minneapolis, particularly at the moment, you see city authorities, it seems to me, that are kind of hell-bent on running the place into the ground. Despite that, Minneapolis and St. Paul remain this really dominant kind of economic engine. But that's not because of policy from the Waltz administration or the Dayton administration or the Pawlenty or the Ventura administrations. Minneapolis has been one of the largest cities in the United States since 1880. Actually, since George Peppard was shooting Lee Van Cleef in How the West Was Won, by the way. But I think what that tells you is that, to some extent, so having this big urban area is going to drive your economic growth. But it's exogenous from current or even recent economic policy. It's kind of a factor of the past. It's you've inherited these things to some extent. So those things will distort your analysis. So if you're comparing economic growth in Minnesota and Wisconsin, for example, which are often seen as being twin states because they're next to each other, the weather's the same, the populations are kind of the same size, but Wisconsin does not have an urban area of comparable size to the Twin Cities. Minnesota has about five of these MSAs as defined by the Census Bureau. Wisconsin, I believe, has 13. Not one of them is anywhere near as big as the Twin Cities. The biggest is Milwaukee. Now, obviously, that's going to have a negative impact, relatively speaking, on Wisconsin's economic growth compared to Minnesota's. But it's not down to economic policy. It's kind of just a factor of economic geography. That can change over time because of policy. But if you're looking at policies over the short run, then obviously that's going to be a factor that you get. You want to try and exclude from your analysis. This is a fairly depressing picture to most Minnesota sports fans, so I'll skip on a bit quickly from this. What I'm going to show you here is how this data comes out when we compare Minnesota to Wisconsin. Now, I wanted to, before I go into this, just remember that we have kind of a theory. So that's that we have all these different economic policies across Minnesota and its neighbors. We have a finding in the empirical literature that high tax burdens slow economic growth. So we can expect to see, if that's correct, when we look at Minnesota and its neighbors, that Minnesota will do relatively badly compared to its neighbors. Now what you have here, these are factors that you have to keep in mind when you look at the Wisconsin comparison. You can exogenize a lot by looking at the border counties, and that's what I do in this paper. By focusing on the border counties, a lot of these things like the Twin Cities or the Bakken oil fields, I can kind of push out of the way. That's more difficult with the Wisconsin comparison for two big reasons. Firstly is the fact that you can't isolate the Twin Cities from this border. It does sit right on the border of the two states. In fact, two of the counties that which the Census Bureau includes in the Twin Cities MSA are in Wisconsin. There are other MSAs along that border. There's La Crosse, and there's also Duluth Superior as well. So that will kind of distort your analysis to the extent that big cities are a driver of growth. And that will make it more difficult to make the comparison. Another one as well is the border. The border between Minnesota and Wisconsin is very largely the St. Croix and Mississippi rivers, which is a factor actually. It's a lot more difficult to cross the Minnesota-Wisconsin border than it is the Minnesota-Iowa border, or the Minnesota-South Dakota or North Dakota borders. They're a lot more porous, and what that means is that there's greater policy space along the Minnesota and Wisconsin border. Which is the space within which policymakers can vary economic policy, tax rates, for example, before they start to lose people across the border. Because when you think about it, you know, at the margin, that decision, if it becomes more expensive, the decision to move here from there, or decision to open here rather than there, to the extent that the cost of that decision is higher, and it's, you know, higher because of these geographic barriers, that will make you less likely to move. It will make you less responsive. So we should expect along this border to see policy less responsive. And we would also expect to see, with the Twin Cities being here, that the tables are tilted slightly in Minnesota's favour. I think you do see that. So this here shows you the percentage change in population from Minnesota and the Wisconsin border counties. And you'll see that the border counties of Minnesota and Wisconsin, Minnesota wins on this one. So a win for the Gophers there, which is, you don't get to say that too often. But there are some interesting things when you start to drill down into the numbers. This shows you the kind of headline numbers, that the population increased in Minnesota by 4.3% over the period, 2.3% in Wisconsin. But that just two counties, Dakota and Washington, which are both in the Twin Cities MSA, accounted for 98% of the growth in the Minnesota border counties. The two Wisconsin counties in that MSA, St. Croix and Pierce, accounted for just about 70% of it, so a lot less. What that suggests is that the population growth on the Wisconsin side of the border is a lot more broadly based. And again, it's that distorting factor of the MSAs. What you're seeing in Minnesota is just that people want to live in cities, which is a demographic trend going back more than a century in this country. In fact, if you remove the four counties from the Twin Cities MSA from these counties, two each from Wisconsin and Minnesota, you actually see that Wisconsin sees faster net population growth, 1.1% compared to 0.2% in Minnesota, which again shows you that the growth is more broadly based on the Wisconsin side and the distorting factor of the MSAs. If you look at the other MSAs on the border, it's interesting to note that the La Crosse MSA, the growth there hasn't spread across into Minnesota. So where growth in the Twin Cities has been matched by growth in Wisconsin, here growth in Wisconsin has not been matched by growth in Minnesota. So you see that neighboring La Crosse County and the neighboring Houston County in Minnesota, the population of La Crosse County increased by about 3%, and it shrunk actually in neighboring Houston County by 2.4%. In Duluth Superior, both counties have lost population, and Wisconsin is slightly worse. That's a win for Minnesota, although it's kind of a negative win, if that's a thing. Move on now to look at some economic numbers. This shows you business creation. The Bureau of Labor Statistics has this clunky name, private establishments. And you'll see that Wisconsin records a win here. What's interesting is you'll see that it's fairly kind of even until about 2014, and then something happens that sets Wisconsin business creation off on a fair old rip, and it takes Minnesota a while. Our rate's caught up since then, our rate now matches, but those kind of crummy years, 14 to 16, have held us back over the whole span of the period. This shows you that the number of businesses in the Wisconsin border counties rose by 11.6%, and just 4.3% in the Minnesota counties. But when you look at jobs, actually the Minnesota counties did better, where employment increased by 11.5% compared to 8.6% in Wisconsin. Perhaps not a huge difference, but it's also worth remembering that the jobs in the Wisconsin counties, don't forget, were created by new businesses, by these new establishments being created. And what Minnesota is reaping there, I think, is some legacy from old large employers. The new jobs are coming in these already established businesses. What's interesting as well is when you start to think about the MSA numbers, Minnesota's border counties have actually seen a net loss of businesses if you strip out Washington and Dakota counties. Whereas by contrast, every single Wisconsin border county has seen business growth. So again, this echoes the point that we made previously, that the growth on the Wisconsin side of the border is a lot more broadly based. It's not just reliant on this urban MSA effect. And then we come on to quality of life measures. You actually see this across the comparisons. This is per capita real personal income, so adjusted for inflation. It comes from three sources. It comes from wages, it comes from capital income, which is like investments, and it also comes from transfer payments, so things like social security, welfare, things like that. You'll see that Minnesota actually wins this one again. It's not a resounding victory, perhaps, 18.6% in Minnesota to 15.8% in Wisconsin. And the shares of new income from the three, wages, capital transfers, all kind of the same, and they kind of grow at the same rate. So there's not really a huge difference between the two counties here. So this brings me to my last slide. This assault of color does appear in the report twice. I liked it that much. And this kind of summarizes the results of what we find when we look at all the border comparisons. So again, remember the theory and the prediction that we had, that Minnesota will do worse because the further you go up that ranking of tax foundation tax burdens, if the empirical literature is correct, that higher tax burdens and increased tax burdens lower economic growth. So let's start by looking at Iowa, which was the one just above us. You see that borne out there. So Iowa, Minnesota losers. Where Minnesota wins, those are the ones in green. We had better population numbers than Iowa. In fact, both border county areas actually lost population there. But Minnesota lost less. So we lose on population, we lose on age of the population in Iowa, and it's a tie in terms of the education level of the population. That didn't really differ at all between the two. But we lose on the others. We lose in the two other categories completely. So the economic measures, businesses and jobs, Minnesota losers. And the standard of living measures, personal income, wages and poverty, we lose on all of those as well. The next one up, of course, is Wisconsin. Now you would expect to see Minnesota do worse than Wisconsin here. You don't. This is the one that kind of bucks the trend. You see that Minnesota actually wins on population, median age, and the education levels of the population. The only ones that we actually win on are the business creation that you saw, and also in poverty levels. Poverty levels decreased by more on the Wisconsin side of the border than they did on the Minnesota side of the border. And that's actually despite the fact that we spend a lot more on welfare per poor person in Minnesota than we do in Wisconsin. So this one kind of bucks the trend, but as I explained, I think that there are distorting factors there which have to be taken into account, the MSA factor, the geographic barriers, so let's carry on and see if the others do the same thing. Well, when we move up to North Dakota, that was 16th on the Tax Foundation rankings, don't forget. Again, the prediction is borne out there. Minnesota does very badly compared to North Dakota. The only places that we win are median age and bachelor's degree. So our population is a bit younger and a bit better educated. And then we move up to South Dakota, where the theory and the prediction would expect us to get a wash, and it pretty much is a wash. We get thrashed by South Dakota on each of these measures. The only one that we win on is personal income. Now, this is an interesting thing. If you read the report, you'll see, if you remember the three sources of personal income, Minnesota only gets its win on personal income against South Dakota because of a growth in transfer payments. A bigger share of South Dakota's personal income growth is driven by wage increases. In Minnesota, it's driven by transfer payment increases. Now, that's bad news, because transfer payments, as the name suggests, are transferred from one person to another. But again, it goes back to the point I started all this with. Wealth has to be generated before it can be transferred and divvied up and shared out. And if you are relying on growth of transfer income to increase per capita personal incomes, at some point in the not very long term, you're going to run into trouble there, and you're going to hit a brick wall. That brings me quite nicely to the end of my talk, and I shall pass you over now to Mike Nicholson, the Badger Institute. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I am Mike Nichols, president of Badger Institute, and I want to thank John and Charlie and our friends at the Center of the American Experiment for including us in this. I only got to listen to John for the first time yesterday down in Stillwater, and I love listening to him, not just because of the brogue. I always learn something. I learned that Bob Dylan was born in Duluth. I thought he was a Hibbing guy, Charlie. Charlie and I were talking about Hibbing earlier. Okay, he didn't move till high school? Okay. So another all right, a reason to love Hibbing and Duluth. I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about Dylan back there.
I was just saying that one of our local jewelers, it's his cousin.
No kidding. Is it Zimmerman?
No.
Okay. All right, I'm digressing, but do I recall correctly that Dylan's last name was Zimmerman? Let's get back on track here. It is funny how many common bonds we have here. When I talk to people who, I was talking to Neil, who went to school in Madison. I think Charlie did. My kids went to school in Madison, and ended up working in Minnesota. I'm kind of the opposite. I grew up in Minnesota and ended up in Wisconsin. Haven't had a chance to meet a lot of the others, but a lot of common bonds here between the states. So I really very much appreciate the opportunity to work with you guys. There are some ways we are different. For a while, we, like you guys, thought we were really a tax hell. And I don't know if that's the word that you use. That's not the Economist word for what's going on. It's not a technical phrase, but we thought that about Wisconsin. And for a long time, we were, back when, frankly, when Jim Doyle was governor before Scott Walker came in. Walker really did cut taxes in Wisconsin quite a bit and, cut taxes by a couple billion dollars. But we felt that something really wasn't right in Wisconsin. Nevertheless, some tax levels were really exceedingly high still. You could see on John's slides, individual income taxes, corporate taxes super high. Sales taxes actually very, very low in comparison to all the contiguous states, not just Minnesota, but Illinois, which really has huge problems right now, that Wisconsin can maybe benefit from some of the exodus from there. So we, despite the fact that tax levels were coming down, wanted to figure out a little bit more about why our growth was a little slower than we thought it should have been. So a lot of what we do at the Badger Institute is we try to go out and find the smartest people in the country that we can, experts on a variety of issues, and we try to bring them into our state and benefit from their knowledge. We do that in a lot of ways. The issues that we're really big on right now, professional licensure reform, a lot of workplace issues. A couple of years back when Walker was governor, we actually were very involved in right to work, major victory for growth in Wisconsin, right to work state now. Very involved, as I said, in workforce issues. We're involved in some corrections reform issues and a variety of other things, but have also over the years been involved in trying to figure out what the best pro-growth tax policy is. So we teamed up with the Tax Foundation in DC, and many of you are probably familiar with the Tax Foundation. They're fantastically smart people on federal tax policy, but also on state level tax policy. So the year before last, several folks from the Tax Foundation came in and actually toured the state with us in Wisconsin. We were all over the state, I bet you, for 8 or 9 months, talking to people about regional differences and how they viewed their tax burdens and benefits at times. That was much less likely. And also did a lot of research. So one of the folks who spent a lot of time in Wisconsin, Catherine Lawhead. And so Catherine's actually from Illinois. I already besmirched that state, so I'll try to be kind about Illinois. It did produce one good thing. That's Catherine Lawhead. Catherine now lives in D.C., and I think, do we have Catherine? We hope. Catherine's beaming in from the Tax Foundation offices, or maybe from her home out in D.C., and is going to present 20 minutes of slides that will show why Wisconsin is better than it used to be on tax levels, but we still have some systemic issues in terms of how taxes are apportioned between income taxes, personal income taxes, corporate taxes, consumption taxes. And then we're, after Catherine speaks, we are going to give all of you an opportunity to ask questions of all of us. Can you hear me there, Catherine? I hope.
Hi, how are you there?
I'm going to hand it over to Catherine Lawhead from...
I'm a little bit of trouble hearing via Zoom, so
sure.
If you'd like me to go ahead and start our presentation.
Sure, sounds good, thank you.
Well, thanks, Mike. I really appreciate that introduction, and I appreciate both your organizations for making it possible for me to join you remotely today. Would really wish to be there in person. Have spent a lot of time in Wisconsin and Minnesota over the past couple of years, so would love to get back there as soon as I can. But DC has a lot of travel restrictions right now, so it's made it really tough for our organization to travel at all this year, but hope to get back there soon. But I will go ahead and share my screen. Overall compared to all the other states. And so when I say policy variables, what I mean there is that we'll ask questions like, is the income tax ladder graduated? Are the brackets indexed for inflation? Is there a marriage penalty in the bracket? Is there an estate tax? And is the property tax pretty uniform, or is there a split roll system in place? And so we believe there's better and worse answers to each of those questions than 120 other different questions. And so basically the states that best adhere to the principles of sound tax policy, so simplicity, neutrality, transparency, and stability, those are the states that are going to perform best on the index. And so here on this map, you can see where each state ranked overall on the index. So you can see Wisconsin was number 25, so right in the middle of the pack. Minnesota, unfortunately, was only 46 out of the 50 states, so tied with DC, but better than only Connecticut, New York, California, and New Jersey. And so there you see also that a lot of the states that ranked in the top 10, shaded there in blue, are states that by and large are able to completely forego one of the major taxes, whether corporate or individual income taxes or the sales tax. A lot of them completely go without one or more of those taxes. And I will point out that a number of them are able to do that because they are very oil-rich states. They have pretty good reliance on severance taxes that enable them to kind of avoid some of the other major taxes, and so that's not an option for Wisconsin or Minnesota, but I will say that several states that do rank in the top 10, specifically looking at Utah at number 8, Indiana at 9, and then North Carolina ranking number 10, those states all levy each of the major taxes, just like Wisconsin and Minnesota, but they do it in a really neutral, stable, simple way. And so those are states that we really want to encourage other states around the country to try to emulate as they look to reform their tax code. And so this slide basically looks at both Wisconsin and Minnesota's overall rankings and then ranks out each of the major components. And so I kind of color-coded things so you can see clearly where Wisconsin is doing particularly well on sales and property taxes, but then where each of the states is kind of in the middle of the pack, they're in orange, and where it could really use improvement in red. And then the plus ones, twos, and threes are basically showing how the rankings improved from last year on each of those components. So I will note that Wisconsin did improve from 26th to 25th overall from last year to this year, but both Wisconsin and Minnesota only improved on certain things because other states made bad decisions around them. And so Wisconsin and Minnesota, neither state made any major changes that were shown on the index this year, but because other states got less competitive, Wisconsin particularly improved overall, and both states improved on certain components. And so, for instance, Virginia used to be ranked 25th with Wisconsin number 26, but because Virginia increased a lot of excise taxes and things like that over the past year, they dropped down to 26 now. So a quick overview of some of the things Wisconsin and Minnesota do well or could use improvement on. Basically, the thing that stands out most for Wisconsin is the sales tax. They're in the top 10 there. And that is in large part due to the state's pretty low sales tax rate. It's actually one of the lowest state rates in the country. And the state also has a good sales tax base, where the base is uniform at the state and local level, and the state does a really good job of adhering to the U.S. Supreme Court's guidance on how to tax out-of-state sellers in a way that avoids imposing undue burdens on them. And so those things all work in Wisconsin's favor there. And then on property taxes, they're ranked 17th, and that might surprise a lot of Wisconsinites who think of their state as a high property tax state, and that is true. But again, the index is not just a matter of burdens or tax collections, but of structure. And overall, actually, Wisconsin does pretty well in terms of how the property tax is structured, and that there is a pretty strong uniformity clause there. The state doesn't use split roll taxation, and the state doesn't have an estate or inheritance or gift tax or a capital stock tax, because we also kind of around average home sales, property, and UI taxes. But really where the state struggles the most is corporate and individual income taxes, worth in the bottom five on both those. And that's primarily due to really high top rates on both those taxes, as well as an alternative minimum tax under both the corporate and individual income tax code. And basically what that is a whole separate tax system under which certain taxpayers have to calculate their tax liability twice and then pay the higher amount. And if they pay the AMT, there's usually less exemptions, there's less benefits, and a higher overall tax burden there. And then the state also doesn't treat business expenses quite as well as it should. So those are a couple things I just want to point out there. So what does this mean for competition along the Wisconsin-Minnesota border specifically? Now, this is kind of a complex question because it's probably rare that a taxpayer would be looking at just Wisconsin versus Minnesota for a place to locate their business or to locate their family. But say some taxpayer business is in this situation. They know they want to live in the Midwest or Northeast, and they're looking at specifically one state or the other. Or say they're already a resident of one of those states or the other. There's certain advantages and disadvantages that both states have. Minnesota, for one, does have an estate tax, while Wisconsin does not. And so for family businesses that might be ready to be passed down to the next generation, that could be a lot more difficult if you live in Minnesota and are subject to that estate tax. And then in Wisconsin, the state and local sales tax rate, like I said earlier, is a lot lower. The combined rate is one of the lowest in the country, while Minnesota's is a lot higher. So I certainly wouldn't be surprised if maybe you've heard stories of people crossing the state line into Wisconsin to make larger taxable purchases in order to take advantage of the lower rate there. However, I would be surprised if there's plenty of people who work in Wisconsin but choose to live right across the border in Minnesota because of the relatively lower effective property tax rates on homeowners. So there's a lot of different things. And it really depends on what your situation is when determining kind of which state might be better tax-wise. But those are things that a lot of businesses will look at. And so on our index, which tries to give kind of a holistic view, Wisconsin is, again, right around average, but there's a lot of tax penalties against businesses, specifically in Minnesota. But I do want to mention one thing I want both states to kind of look at moving forward. And that's the fact that Iowa is starting to improve its tax code. Now, Iowa has never historically been considered a competitive tax state. It's always been kind of low ranked on our index. But the state made a lot of really good tax reforms in 2018 that have already started to take effect, and some are yet to take effect. And so the things that already took effect have already improved the state's index ranking from 45th overall last year to 40th this year. So it used to be neck and neck with Minnesota, and now it's jumped several places higher. And that's due to things like improved treatment of small business machinery and equipment investments and of business interest expenses, and completely removing international income from the tax base, or GILTI. And then some big changes that have yet to take effect are actually a reduction in the corporate income tax rate. Iowa has one of the highest rates right now at 12%, but that's dropping to 9.8% on January 1st. And that 9.8% probably looks familiar if you live in Minnesota, and it's no coincidence that that is what Iowa was targeting its rate for, to try to maintain more competitiveness with Minnesota specifically. And then the top individual income tax rate is also going to drop, effective January 1st of 2023, and that is subject to a revenue trigger, so hopefully the state is able to kind of rebound a bit from this recession, and then those should take effect. But those are just some things to keep in mind, that states around, or at least one state around Iowa, Wisconsin and Minnesota is getting better, and now Illinois very well might be getting worse as of next week. Who knows if the graduated rate income tax will take a pretty problematic for both Wisconsin and Minnesota. Minnesota's is the fourth highest marginal, or top marginal corporate income tax rate in the country, and Wisconsin's is 15th highest. And so if you look kind of closely at the map there, you'll see that of all the states in the contiguous U.S. along the Mississippi or west of it, only California and Louisiana have top rates that are higher than the kind of cluster of Minnesota, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Illinois. And then actually, of course, there are some higher rates in the Northeast, but really, even in the Northeast, New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and New Hampshire all have rates that are lower than both Minnesota and Wisconsin. And so that's something to be aware of. Now, I will say that kind of in the same breath that I say that it's important for both states to work on reducing the top corporate rate, it's also important to consider reducing reliance on targeted tax breaks. And I say that because these tax breaks are often implemented into the tax code kind of as a way to keep up with the Joneses, and they're often implemented because everyone else is doing it, and it's sold as a way to kind of increase investment in a state. But there's been a ton of studies done that really show that, by and large, most incentives merely subsidize a lot of business activity and investments that would be occurring anyway. And so in most cases, a better use of that revenue would be to kind of curb back some of those incentives a bit and dedicate that revenue toward reducing that top corporate rate, for reducing individual income tax rates as well. And now, the next kind of priority I think I have for both states would be to reduce the top individual income tax rate. So this is a very similar map. Minnesota has the fifth highest top marginal individual income tax rate in the U.S. Wisconsin is the 10th highest. And so this is obviously burdensome to a lot of families and a lot of individuals, but it's also really burdensome to most of the state's small businesses. Because pass-through businesses don't pay the corporate rate, they are paying individual income taxes, and oftentimes that's top rate. And so this is affecting all those partnerships and LLCs, sole proprietorships, S-corps, they're all paying individual income taxes. And so that's a big reason to kind of prioritize reducing all income tax rates. Now, very quickly, looking at kind of comparing the bracket structures in both Wisconsin and Minnesota, they're both somewhat similar in that they have four brackets each, and they each have a pretty high rate. And the top rate kicks in at a relatively low income level in both states. So you see that in Minnesota, that 9.85% rate kicks in at only $164,400 for single filers, and not quite double that for married filers. And so you're getting a lot of middle income people kind of trapped up into that top rate. So that's not just hitting the very wealthy, it's hitting a lot of individuals and families and a lot of small businesses. And also another thing to point out is that there is a marriage penalty where the bracket widths are not doubled for married couples what they are for single filers. And so what that does is it makes the effective tax rate a lot higher on a number of people when they get married than they would be if they were paying separately under just as single filers. So if both states kind of consider reforming their tax codes, looking to get rid of that marriage penalty would be a really good decision. And then the last thing I'll mention is just the importance of sales tax modernization. And so basically, right now, the sales tax applies to most goods we buy with some major exemptions, like in Minnesota, clothing isn't subject to the sales tax, which is a pretty big exemption. But most goods are subject to the sales tax, while most services are not. So, for example, if you go to get your hair cut, you will, and then go to grab a bottle of shampoo right before you check out, that shampoo will be taxed, but the service of getting your hair cut will not be taxed. And really, this doesn't make a whole lot of economic sense. It's really not very intentional. It was kind of the result of a historic accident where sales taxes were largely adopted around the 1930s or modeled after states that first adopted them in the 1930s, when the sales tax was a lot more, or I guess consumption was a lot more goods-based and services-based. But now it's really services have increased while goods have declined as a share of total consumption, as you see in that chart. And that means the sales tax base has eroded over time, and the sales tax is not making the same amount of revenue in real terms that it once was. And so that is what has driven so many sales tax rates that we've seen over the past several decades. And so what we have now is a pretty narrow-based high rate tax, when what most economists of all stripes believe is a good tax policy is broad-based low rate taxation. And so moving forward, broadening that sales tax base to additional consumer goods and services can, number one, generate more state and local tax revenue. But we're not saying that states and localities should just pocket that revenue. We really want that revenue to be used to bring down the rates that are most economically harmful, so corporate and individual income tax rates. So I know I just went over quite a bit of material, but I am more than happy to answer any questions, and I think the others are going to join me for Q&A as well.
Thank you for that. That's fascinating and depressing at the same time, actually. We've got time for a couple of questions, so I would like to throw it open. You've got me, Catherine, and Mike here, so any questions? Yes.
I must be in the dark ages, but the marriage tax penalty, do you want to explain that?
Catherine, I'll pass that one over to you. The marriage tax penalty, would you like to explain that?
Can you text her? Or?
Yeah.
Oh.
I can take a shot at it.
Yeah, sure.
It's just that if you look at the amount of money that you make as a couple, it's much less than double what you would make as an individual to be subject to that tax level.
Yeah.
So as a result, you're paying more if you're married. And I can't believe it's so low in Wisconsin. In Minnesota, but it's what is it? 200
and
270. Yeah,
and
right. And it should be 320, right? If I saw that correctly, it should be 320 or 30. John, did I explain that?
That's not bad. Yeah, but not many states have it. We are one of the ones that do.
I can't hear very well what's going on, so I think I just got a question about explaining the marriage penalty. Yeah, I'd be more than happy to explain that. So basically, a marriage penalty occurs when the bracket width in a graduated rate income tax system are not exactly double what they are for married filers as they are for single filers. And so you will end up basically having more of your income subject to a higher marginal rate when you get married and combine that income than you will as two single individuals. So if you can bear with me for just a second, I can try to go back to the brackets real quick and show you specifically what I mean here. So in Minnesota, for example, if you're two single individuals making $80,000 each, you will have some of your income subject to that 5.25% rate and some subject to the 6.8% rate, but it won't go higher than that if you're making $80,000 of income. However, if you get married and still each make $80,000, so you have $160,000 combined, now you have some of that income subject to that 7.85% rate. And so your effective rate on that $168,000 of income as a married couple is a lot higher than it would be if you filed separately or if you stayed single, because then you'd be only still, the top rate you'd be subject to at all would be that 6.8% rate.
Yeah, one of the things that this does, and it's like the AMT thing that was mentioned as well, is that it makes Minnesota's taxes more awkward and burdensome than they need to be. So for example, if you're a married couple, it's more sensible to file separately than it is to file together. The AMT is another one of those things that adds another layer of complexity. So there are actually a few things that Minnesota could do in terms of policy to bump us up these rankings that wouldn't necessarily involve tax rate cuts, necessary though they are. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just saying, I guess, you know, you're hearing that the Democrat strategy is to tax the rich, the higher up, which I'm just hearing that the objective tax foundation and economic rules show that that is bad policy for economic growth. How does that message get out? I mean, it's just interesting to find that that stark contrast needs to be made.
There's a couple of things I'd say about that. The first thing is that policymakers are really stupid when it comes to taxes for the most part. And they're either stupid or dishonest. So, for example, they will hike taxes on cigarettes because they want you to smoke less. And, you know, the cigarette tax, in theory, the ideal revenue from that is $0. Because if the tax goes up and everyone stops smoking, bang, there's no revenue. Now, people use that idea that taxes are a disincentive is a cornerstone of that entire branch of economic policy. Why that logic is ditched and abandoned and not applied when you talk about taxation on investment or taxation on labour, like you can tax labour and investment income and labour and investment will be unchanged. I don't understand how you can justify applying the logic in one case and not in the other. Another thing about taxing the rich is, you know, you can try it, but if you look at Scandinavia, for example, which is everybody's poster boy, you know, that's where they got this huge government sector, huge government spending. But it's not the rich that pay for it. In Scandinavia, disproportionately, their welfare systems and their government spending is financed by heavier taxes on the middle classes. And, you know, sales taxes and things like that. And I don't think that many of the people here in this country who hold Sweden, for example, up as an example of tax policy have ever actually thought for 2 seconds about what Sweden's tax policy really is. I think they'd run a mile screaming if they had. And this is the thing. If you look at your income taxes, trying to tax the rich, there's nobody better at not paying the taxes if they don't want to than the rich. And I'm not saying that they have to, you know, resort to illegal methods. There's a lot you can do at the margin, perfectly legally. So you can move to South Dakota, for one thing, which we see in the numbers in our report. There's all sorts of things you can do. You can change the way that your income is received, change the way it's reported. It's all perfectly legal, which is why, actually, and it's an interesting finding, if you look at the history of tax rates in Minnesota, and it's the same thing at the federal level, actually, tax rates are low, they're high, they're low, they're high. The share of GDP, for example, taken in tax revenue does not change by that level. It went way up in World War II, but I think that's because most people thought, you know, look, I don't mind paying a bit of tax to defeat Hitler or to defeat Imperial Japan. You know, money well spent in my book. But there is a difference now. You've raised tax levels way high after that, and you do not get the same response in terms of the share of the country's income that the country hands over. And that's because most people who are on kind of regular incomes, they get their tax rates go up, and there's not a lot they can do because their main source of income is wages. But if you're a higher rate taxpayer, if you're earning more, your sources of income might be more varied, and there's more variation in what you can do. So, you know, I think that is where you find the response to that, really. Yes, sir?
Before she goes, because her slides were abundant, and you might have to translate the question, but the 9.8% sort of rack rate on taxes in the state of Minnesota and now Iowa is actually reduced by lots of different credits. What is the effective rate after those credits? Do you know that number?
I don't know what it is. It is true that if you look at the headline rate of corporate tax in Minnesota, it's a touch misleading because, for example, we exclude earnings that companies earn out state. So, for example, you've got 3M, and 3M is taxed or targets taxed on what it makes in Minnesota. But, you know, that's what percentage of 3M's revenue? Not that much. It's actually almost kind of regressive. Because if you're, you know, like some store in Minneapolis that's competing with a Target, then you know the amount of your income that's taxable in Minnesota is basically all of it. Whereas if you're Target, it's much less. I'm not sure if Catherine's got that question now. Maybe she'd like to.
Excellent. I hope I'm not interrupting.
deductibility. So federal taxes paid are deductible against your state income taxes, which is kind of weird. Iowa did that. But that's actually going to be eliminated as of January 1st, too. So there are some base changes taking effect along with the rate changes. It's not just a straight rate change from 12 to 9.8% with no other base changes. So it is some base broadening in a good way. Federal deductibility is not good policy and kind of should be eliminated. But I don't know the specifics of what the exact effective rate would be at a specified dollar level. I guess it would be, you know, kind of it depends a lot on any taxpayer's individual situation.
One last question, if there is one.
Have you studied Minnesota is a little unique in the sense that it has a provider tax for healthcare, and so we tax the providers, and then that goes into the Minnesota Medicaid system, and that's why we're at 95% insured. And I know Wisconsin does not have that, and the question, you know, they just renewed it here a little bit less, but it's still like providers are basically having to kind of give money to the state system to get themselves reimbursed at a really low rate, 35 cents on the dollar for Medicaid. Has anybody studied that at the national system? I mean, I love the idea that, of course, that we've covered ourselves for our insured to some extent, you know, without having to do Obamacare or other things that change nothing here in Minnesota.
Yeah, at the national level. At the national level, I pass over to Kathy. At the local level, it's kind of a weird tax, and I'm not really sure that the revenue is paying for the things that people think it's paying for. I think just recently in the bonding bill, it got rated as just kind of some general slush fund, which is, you know, money is fungible anyway, so...
Right, that was the one thing they forgot to put on.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of a weird thing, you know, we're going to help people get medical coverage by, you know, taxing illness. Seems a strange thing.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like smoking. You know, you can quit smoking. You can't necessarily quit being ill. But at the national level, I don't know is the answer. So, okay. Well, what I would say is thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to come up here. It's a beautiful part of the state. I hope we'll be up here very soon. Maybe not in the winter, obviously. I'd like to thank Mike, actually. He heard all my talking yesterday. I catch you afterwards. I'd like to thank Mike. He heard all my jokes yesterday, and he still laughed along with them today as well. And I'm more than happy to come back and do a talk on Bob Dylan, if you'd like that. I might even bring my harmonica and neck rack, so you've got that to look forward to. But thanks again. It's been a pleasure.
I would just add, I think, do we have copies of this?
Yes, they're out on the table.
Right, so if anybody wants to, there's stuff in here on the marriage, and I'll see some of the other questions. And you can also find this on our website, which is badgerinstitute.org. So we're
also assuming that everybody is already on the mailing list for thinking Minnesota, and if you're not, it's free, and you just pick one up and use the subscription sheet inside of it. And also, of course, feel free to grab them and give them to friends, family, Democrats in your circles, everybody who needs re-education. And as John said, we really want to more people in the room next time we all count. So to the extent that you know, you want to encourage friends and acquaintances to be involved in the center and help us make that happen, please do. And we of course would love to be back doing things together with Badger and
Team. Can I make a couple of generalizations,
please,
or general observations? Well, hey, we've talked a lot about taxes here. Observation on my part is that from past experience and from past reading, if you want to increase tax revenues, and I didn't see the association between tax revenues and taxation, but it seems to me, as I understand it, in order to increase tax revenues, you need to decrease taxes. If you want to decrease revenues, you increase taxes. That's a generalization. Everything that you talked about today more or less pointed towards that. I'm going to draw a historical item, and that's we go back about 20 years. I think to this date the most expensive tax ever levied on the American public was the 10% surtax on boats valued over $100,000. And that tax, if I recall, and this goes back a ways, but it seems to me that there were 68,000 people that lost their jobs as a result of that. And all the boat manufacturing companies went out of business. So take the equivalency of the loss of wages from that one tax and the welfare payments that were made from that one tax and all of the other subsequent taxes, it was in the billions and billions and billions of dollars, not to mention it destroyed an entire industry which has never come back. So that's number one, tax revenues versus that. I look at, you know, I'm a Minnesota resident and I've been a businessman in Minnesota for 40 years. And I look at some of the things that you say, and you know, I can recall going across the bridge and picking up major orders that I would get in, and I would pick them up in Wisconsin because I'd save that sales tax. I look even today, when I do construction and I have to go to a Menards, I go to the Menards that's in Wisconsin because it's a significantly less sales tax. So, in addition to that, we can look at some other facets inside of Minnesota. For example, I'm a pilot now and I own a couple of airplanes that I lease out. My hangar is in Wisconsin, Superior, Wisconsin. Part of the reason for that is because Minnesota taxes airplanes at an extremely higher level. So, there again, Minnesota has lost that revenue. Minnesota loses the sales tax revenue when I go to Menards and Superior, which is right across from my hangar. Minnesota loses that revenue. So it's the age-old saying, do you want 100% of something, or 100% of nothing, or you want, you know, 2% of something? And it makes a huge, huge difference when it comes down to that. You can carry it further. Every time I cross the bridge, I look at trucking companies. I drive past Amsoil. Those are all Minnesota companies. They've all exited Duluth, Minnesota, and gone to Wisconsin because of the favorable taxation.
Ironic is that. Yeah. The arena is branded by Amsoil.
Absolutely.
They had to flee because of these
calls. But Al was a friend of mine, but he was also a Minnesota resident. And it came up in Minnesota. So he's a Minnesota guy. That's why he donated the money before he died to the Amsoil Arena. So we look at those types of things. You look at the estate taxes, and you also look at 6 months in a day. It's not just a few people that do that.
Right.
I know tons of people that spend 6 months in a day outside of Minnesota. Why? Because of taxes. And we're forcing them out. So, as I watched your program, and I watched it with great interest, and I'm very complimentary of your program that you presented, I guess I still, in the back of my mind, going, whose side are you on? I don't know. Because I get to the end, and I know you're showing facts and figures and that sort of thing, but I don't know if you're pro-Wisconsin, pro-Iowa, you know, I guess I don't know.
It's really just a question of being pro-sound policy, I think. The point you make about rates and revenues, there's a famous thing, the Laffer curve, which relates tax rates and tax revenues. And what that shows you is that if you tax revenues at 0%, your revenue will be zero. If you tax it at 100%, your revenue will be zero because nobody will do anything. There is some point between the two at which you maximize revenue. And the Laffer curve really is the relationship between rates and revenues. It's a great theoretical tool. I would be very skeptical of trying to calculate one in real life. But as a pedagogic thing, it's very, very useful. The thing about estate taxes, it's absolutely true. Minnesota is one of the few states that has one. We've done a study on this, and we found that if you set the revenue that the estate tax brings in, which is A, not a lot of money, and B, very variable, if you set that revenue against the amount of revenue that you push out of the state, in terms of the sales taxes and income taxes and all the rest of it, that people would pay when they go, then you actually work out that the estate tax loses money for Minnesota's government, and that Minnesota's government would have more money. I don't spend my days trying to think about how Minnesota's government can spend more money, but if they got rid of the estate tax, they would have more people and more money in the state. And that does go to show that there is, at some point, this question of rates and revenues. But I would say also that when you look at the relationship between rates and revenues, so tax rates and then tax revenues as a share of GDP, you, as I said in the talk, you don't see the responsiveness. And that's because the majority of taxes, actually income taxes in the state, are paid by the wealthier. And they are the people who are most able to adjust their taxable behavior. The average guy, the average woman isn't. You know, they get most of their income from their employer, it comes in their checks, and there's not too much they can do to change that in terms of, in response to tax policy. The higher rate taxpayers, they do have that ability because their income tends to come from a range of sources. And so you don't see, you see a greater responsiveness. It's the same point I made actually in regards to the geographic thing about policy space. You have less, you have more policy space, ironically, as a politician, to rinse the average person than you do to rinse rich people. They can, you know, tell you to take a long walk a lot easier.
It goes back to what you said. The rich people, they have the ability and the talent to adjust so that they don't have to pay those higher taxes.
They do indeed, yeah.
And it's, then there are so many examples of that in Minnesota. Classic example, I used to get all my radio work done for my airplanes down in Anoka, at a radio shop at the Anoka Airport. All right? Anoka falls under MAC, Minneapolis Airport Commission, okay? They take a percent, or two, whatever it is, but it's significant. I went to Brainerd this last year. I had $150,000 worth of radio work done. I didn't have to pay any MAC work, or any MAC fees. So, here again, Minnesota is losing out because of that, you know, do they want 1% of something, or do they want 100% of nothing?
Yeah.
And they're driving business away from Minneapolis business people.
Yeah, I've written about the boat tax on our website before, and this would be my kind of final thing on it, would be that the ideal in terms of tax reform is to get a low rate on a broad base. If you look at boat tax, I mean, how many people own a boat? Not that many. So, you know, if you're taxing boat ownership, boat purchase, it's a narrow tax base. And, you know, once you start whacking high rates on it, people are very able to respond to it by just not owning boats and finding something else to do with their time. And it's the point that Kath made, you know, about broadening the tax base, bringing services into taxation. Because once you've got a broader tax base, you can bring the rates down. It's like when you start to tax the rich, you know, if you're taxing the 1%, that's a very narrow tax base. And if you start whacking high rates on them, off they go. And you don't, they don't necessarily need to leave the country. They just need to kind of change their behavior. And I think that's something that gets lost quite a lot in the discussion. There are ways not to get taxed short of just, you know, skipping to Bermuda or something. Anyway, I shall have to cut us off there, otherwise I'm going to get gonged off by the staff. But I'd like to say thank you very much once again. It's been a pleasure.